Hope everyone can listen me very clearly.
Yes, sir.
Okay, let's discuss two popular algorithms on face detection. So today we will talk about fingerprint verification and thumbprint verification. Okay. So today we will talk about only fingerprint verification. Then in the next class we will talk about thumbprint verification. So these are the sources based on which I have prepared these slides on fingerprint verification and thumbprint verification. So you can use these sources for your study. So here, before we start fingerprint verification, I would like to introduce about fingerprint recognition system. So fingerprint recognition system have been used for more than 100 years, and it is widely used as a form of biometrics authentication system. Okay, so today biometrics fingerprint verification system, many people find it's very synonymous, this fingerprint verification system with biometric system, because everywhere we can see these fingerprint verification systems are being used for identification as well as for verification purpose. Okay, even in case of time attendance system, fingerprint verification system is found to be very popular biometric systems for such applications. Okay, so fingerprint verification system, fingerprint is unique to every individual, and it remains unchanged over a lifetime. Okay, so whenever we see a fingerprint pattern in an image, then if we can have the fingerprint image, the same fingerprint image after 5 years or after 10 years, we can see that the pattern has not been changed. Okay, the pattern remains same on the same fingerprint. So here you can see that there are two fingerprint images, and these two fingerprint images are obtained from two individuals, two different individuals, or from the same individuals. Okay, now we have to find a match between these two fingerprint impressions or two fingerprint images. Okay, now there are some basic characteristics, or we can have some more characteristics. Based on those characteristics, we can find a match between these two fingerprint impressions. Okay, now how this fingerprint formation is done. So fingerprint formation is basically depends upon the finger the pattern reach. Okay, so the pattern reach is responsible to form a fingerprint image or fingerprint pattern. Okay, so here ridge is nothing but a single curve, and between two ridges we can have a valley. So there are ridges and valleys. So here you can see that the black lines or black curves represent the ridges, and the white regions represent the valleys. So here ridges are nothing but the curves, or if we consider a single ridge on a fingerprint pattern, then that ridge represent will that ridge will represent a single curve, and a valley will be found between two ridges. Okay, so here white regions or white curves represent the valley. Now, what are the good points and bad points about fingerprint verification? So there are some advantages and disadvantages of fingerprint verification system. Let's have a look at those points. So good points are as follows. So long tradition of using fingerprint in law enforcement. So we can find that fingerprint has been using for more than a century. Okay, so this fingerprint has been using in law enforcement agencies for the long time. So there is a legacy of fingerprint database. So fingerprint database has a legacy. That means we can have different types of fingerprint images that constitute the fingerprint database. So we can have the ink-based fingerprint. So ink-based fingerprints are mostly available in case of law enforcement or criminal investigations, or when we cross a border or cross the border from one country to another country, then in the immigration section they capture the slab fingerprint, okay, ink based slab fingerprint on a plain paper. So that may constitute the fingerprint database. Nowadays we have the digital fingerprint image, so therefore we have the large number of fingerprint images in fingerprint database. Now in terms of security, it is more secure than the password and ID cards, okay, and ease of use, it is easy to use and simple. So fingerprint are non-transferable, okay. Higher level of accountability at work and cost effective. Now if we consider a comparison between fingerprint verification with face recognition and iris recognition, then we always choose the fingerprint verification or fingerprint system. Why? Because there are some advantages of fingerprint system over face and iris recognitions, because face pattern is a dynamic pattern. Okay, so face recognition accuracy depends upon various factors. The factors like unconstrained environment, factors like pose changes, factors like illumination, factors like facial expression. So these are the factors that affect the accuracy in face recognition system. In case of iris recognition is not the user friendly. That means people are feared to give the iris sample for recognition purpose. Okay, but if we see the fingerprint verification or fingerprint system, then fingerprint is user friendly. So first of all, it is the user friendly, and people usually give these samples for recognition and identification purpose. Okay, now what are the disadvantages of this fingerprint system? So we can have the system failures. Okay, scanners are subject to technical errors and have some limitations. So the scanners that we are using to capture the fingerprint images or fingerprint pattern may have some technical errors. Okay, and have some limitations. Limitations like if the displacements occurred on the plate of the scanners, then it may give the bad fingerprint image. Okay, and that leads to degraded degraded accuracy or verification accuracy. And the second point is implementation and maintenance cost is high for small organization. If the small organization is using the fingerprint verification system, then the implementation and maintenance cost will be high for that organization. For the large organization, it is okay, but for a small organization, the implementation and maintenance cost is too high. A certain percentage of population does not have valid fingerprint for using the system. A certain percentage means 2% population, 2% world population does not have the valid fingerprint or legitimate fingerprint for using the system. So these are the disadvantages of fingerprint verification system. Now, if we look at a fingerprint pattern or fingerprint image, then we can see there are some unique points, unique characteristics which are present on a fingerprint pattern. Okay, so on the ridges we can have arches, we can have loops, we can have holes. Okay, we can have valleys on a fingerprint pattern. We can see the crossover, we can see the core, we can see the bifurcation or fork. We can see the regenting, we can have the high island, we can have the delta point, we can have pores. Okay, now what is arches? So arches means that arches form a wave-like pattern on a fingerprint image. Okay, wave-like pattern. So basically arch is a wave-like pattern on a fingerprint image. And what is loop? So loop formation basically consists of a ridges which enters from one side, okay, and it recurves, then it goes back to the same side or the other side, okay, and hole are the spiral formation on a fingerprint image, spiral or circular formation on a fingerprint image. Okay, and you know what is valleys. So valleys are found between any two ridges or a pair of ridges. And here minutiae, if we consider the other features also, like crossover, core, bifurcation, regenting, then this regenting and ridge bifurcations are the two main features which are called the minutiae features. And these minutiae features mainly used for identification or verification purpose. That means these minutiae features are collected from a fingerprint image, then these minutiae features are encoded into a feature vector, and that feature vector is used for matching and further identification or and verification. Okay, so here minutiae features includes regenting and ridge bifurcation. What is regenting? So here you can see the regenting when some ridge is suddenly in its continuation, then that point will be called, or that end point will be called regenting. Okay, so this is the dead point for a ridge curve. Okay, what is ridge bifurcation? So ridge bifurcation form a Y-like shape means this is the point where a ridge bifurcated or divided into two different ridges or sub ridges. Okay, so this point will also be called a minutiae feature or minutiae point. Okay, so therefore regenting and ridge bifurcation are called minutiae points, and these points are considered for fingerprint matching and further verification and identification. Okay, so we can have many other features apart from these minutiae features. We can have the crossover, we can have core, okay, we can have the island, we can have delta point, we can have pores. Pores means the sweat pores. Okay, these sweat pores exhibit the points which can be observed in high resolution fingerprint image. Okay. So here we can see the rich characteristics. So what are the different rich characteristics we can see on a fingerprint image? So we can see the core point, we can see ridge ending, okay, we can see short ridge. Okay, short ridge means a short curve, okay, on a ridge. And then we can see the fork or bifurcation, we can see a delta point. So delta, so here you can see a delta point. Delta point means the this is the point from where three ridges are emerges. Okay, so three ridges are emerged. So we can have the hook. Hook means the small ridge is attached to a big curve. That means the big ridge. Okay, we can have eye-like formation. We can have a dot or island between any two ridges. Then we can have the crossover of ridges. Okay, we can have bridge. That means a small ridge is connected is connect two ridges. Okay, we can have enclosures. So these are the different ridge characteristics that are found on a fingerprint image or fingerprint pattern. So apart from minutia points or minutia features, we can have a set of other features that are also considered for identification or verification. Now if we look at a fingerprint image or fingerprint pattern very carefully, then we see that there are three main patterns are available with the world population. Okay, so 60 to 70% population is having the loop patterns. Okay, so here you can see the left hand image represent the loops or loop pattern, and the middle fingerprint image represent the hole pattern. Okay, and arches, as I said, that arches form a wave like pattern on a fingerprint image, and hole pattern basically form a spiral or circular pattern on a fingerprint image. And loops basically the ridges which enters from one side and it recurve, okay, or recede around other ridges, and when and it exit from the same side or from the other side of the pattern. Okay, so here we can have the loops, holes, arches. So these are the three main patterns which have been observed in world population. Now here we can see a typical fingerprint verification system. So in a typical fingerprint verification system, we can have a number of subsystems. So one such subsystem is fingerprint segmentation. So in the input, we take and fingerprint a fingerprint image, and that fingerprint image is subjected to fingerprint segmentation. Okay, so after fingerprint segmentation, we go for orientation field estimation, and after orientation estimation, we go for fingerprint enhancement. Okay, after fingerprint enhancement, we can go for fingerprint classification. And then we have fingerprint ridge thinning. So these are the basically pre-processing steps: fingerprint segmentation, orientation estimation, fingerprint enhancement, then fingerprint classification, fingerprint thinning. So these first five steps are part of fingerprint pre-processing. Okay, then we can have the minutia extraction. So in this subsystem, we extract the minutia features or minutia points. Okay, That means the regenting and ridge bifurcation points we extract in this minutiae extraction subsystem. So after extracting minutiae points, we go for minutiae matching. That means after encoding the minutiae points as a feature vector, then we go for minutiae matching. The minutiae matching, we match the encoded vector with stored template, and that gives us the matching result. Okay, so matching result in terms of, so here matching result mean in terms of matching scores or matching proximity, we obtain the matching result, and based on this result we can verify a subject, or we can accept a subject, or we can reject a subject, or we can identify some unknown person based on the matching result. Now for fingerprint acquisition, what are the different types of sensors are used? We can have a number of sensors that we can use for capturing the fingerprint pattern or fingerprint image. Okay, so we can have the optical sensor, we can have capacitive sensor, we can have ultrasound sensor, we can have thermal sensor. Now how these sensors works? So if we go for the COTS system, COTS system means commercial of the self, system, then for every commercial application we use that optical fingerprint optical sensor. Okay, so this how this optical sensor works. The optical sensor consists of three main components. The first component is called the illumination sources. Okay, second component is called platen, or the plate where we place our finger. Okay, and the third component is the imaging lens. Okay, so in the illumination sources we use the a number of leads. So these leads, when we place our thumb on the sensor plate, okay, then this illumination sources are used to illuminate the ridges. That means only the ridge, so ridges will be found which will be in contact with the sensor plate. And when the illumination will be used to illuminate the ridges which are in contact with the optical sensor plate, then there will be a reflection of lights. So one reflection or scatter light will be reflected from the ridges, and another internal reflection will be there for the valleys. Okay, so that is why that image is created, and this imaging lens is used to form the fingerprint pattern. Okay, and there is an imaging array, and this imaging array basically used for formation of the fingerprint pattern. That means these three main components will be used in the optical fingerprint sensor, and using these three components we can capture a fingerprint pattern or a fingerprint image. So here you can see on the right hand side, you can see an optical fingerprint sensor, optical reader. Then we can have the capacitive sensor or capacitive reader. So in capacitive reader, we can have an array of electrodes. Okay, so here you can see that array of electrodes, which are also called the capacitive array. Okay, and when we place our fingerprint on the sensor, then we also consider our skin as as electrodes. Okay, then that means when the skin, when the ridges getting contacted with the sensor, then there will be a, then the small small electrical charge is created. Okay, and this charge is captured by silicon substrate. So there will be a silicon substrate that are, and that is used to capture the small charges that that are been created when the skin getting contacted with the sensor. Okay, so that means there will be a capacitor array, or the array of electrodes are already there in the sensor. Okay, and here we consider the skin surface is also also as an electrode. Okay, when the skin surface getting contact getting contacted with the sensor, then there will be a small charges that are to be created. Okay, and this small charges are recorded by the active circuits. Okay, so in terms of silicon, there will be a silicon substrate, and this capacitor, is responsible to store these charges, and these charges form an image, and this image is called the range image. Okay, so basically, capacitor reader creates a range image, and it is this capacitor reader is commonly used, fingerprint reader, and this capacitor reader is used in most of the computer systems, in the mobile phones. Okay, so in place of optical sensor is basically used for commercial purposes. So in most of the core system, commercial of the self systems, optical sensor is used. But for the small systems like mobile phones, like laptops, like desktop, so for these systems we use capacitive reader or capacitive sensor. So this capacitive sensor is responsible to generate a range image. Now we can have the ultrasound reader. So here on the right hand side you can see a an image of ultrasound reader. So ultrasound reader is having two main components. One is called the center sender, another is called the receiver. So sender means here acoustic signal is sent by the sender. When the acoustic signal, that means when a person is placing his thumb on the ultrasound reader, then the sender sends the acoustic signal to the sensor. Okay, that means the plate where the person is placed his finger. Then when the acoustic signal is sent to the plate, then that bounce off this sensor, or that plate bounce off the, that means this, that signal is bounce off from that plate, and it generates an image. That means this signal is generated an image of the fingerprint pattern. And then this pattern is available, when this pattern is available on the ultrasound radar, then only that sender can send the acoustic signal, and this acoustic signal is bounce off from the finger, from the ultrasound plate, and that creates a fingerprint pattern or fingerprint image. Okay, the next fingerprint reader is the thermal reader or thermal sensor. So here thermal sensor basically uses the heat of the skin. When the when the skin or the ridges getting contacted with the fingerprint sensor, then that heat is measured by the sensor. Okay, and there is another flux that are kept in the fingerprint sensor or thermal sensor. So there we measure the difference between these two parameters, okay, the values of these parameters, and then we get the image, the corresponding image in the form of fingerprint pattern. Okay, so basically here we get the differential thermal measurement, and this differential thermal measurement is responsible to form a fingerprint pattern or fingerprint image. Now, what are the different fingerprint features we can use, or what are the different fingerprint features which are available on a fingerprint image or a fingerprint pattern? Okay. Now here you can see there are four different images. The first image represents the grayscale image of a fingerprint pattern. Okay, and here next image, that is figure B, represent the level one feature. So what is level one feature? So basically level one feature represent the orientation field or ridge flow and the singular points. So these three features are considered as the level one feature. First, the orientation field. So then that means the orientation field of every point and the ridge flow and singular points. Okay. And figure C represent the level two features. What is level two features? So level two features correspond to the ridge skeleton, and this ridge skeleton will contain the minutiae features or the minutiae points, that is the ridge ending or ridge bifurcation. So this ridge ending and ridge bifurcation are considered as level two features. And the last figure, that is a figure D, represent the level three features. So level three features are obtained from a high resolution image. That means the if we able to create a high resolution fingerprint image, then that image will contain the level three features. Okay, so what are the level three features? So level three features include ridge contour and ridge contour, sweat pore and dots. Okay, so these three features are mainly considered as level three features, and these level three features are not seen or are not found on a normal fingerprint image. We need the high resolution image to have these level three features. Okay, that means when we extract the features, we need to consider these three different levels of features. If we need the better accuracy of the fingerprint image or the fingerprint pattern, then we can add the level two features with level three features. Okay, so level two features give us the minutiae points, and level three features give us the ridge contour, sweat pore and dots. So if we integrate these two different sets of features, then we can have a distinctive set of features, and we can use this distinctive set of features for matching purpose and verification and identification purpose. Any question from here? If you have any questions, you can ask me.
No, sir.
Okay. Now we will talk about the fingerprint enhancement or fingerprint pre-processing. So why do you need the fingerprint enhancement? So fingerprint, the perfect fingerprint image is very rare to have in acquisition process, because the fingerprint during acquisition, fingerprint acquisition, so we can have the non different we can have different noises on a fingerprint pattern, which are these noises are attached to a fingerprint pattern, and these noises are created during acquisition process. Okay, so what are the different noises? So noise may contain the scars. Okay, so scar, bruises, okay, dart. So many person do not have the legitimate finger. Okay, so these are the different difficulties or different noises, or we can have the low resolution image, we can have the dark fingerprint image. So these are the different noises. Okay, now if we want to get a clear fingerprint image or the high quality fingerprint image, then we should go through the fingerprint enhancement process or fingerprint pre-processing process. Okay, so pre-processing is nothing but applying some basic basic digital image processing techniques. So these digital image processing techniques will enhance the fingerprint image. So here enhancement means the quality will be better for verification or identification purpose. That means before we go for fingerprint feature extraction, we should have the fingerprint enhancement process. So through the fingerprint enhancement process, we get a better quality fingerprint image, or the clear fingerprint image, or the clear fingerprint area from where we can extract the fingerprint features for verification or identification purpose. Now, what are the different fingerprint enhancement steps are there? We have the normalization. Okay, then we have orientation estimation, we have reach frequency estimation, we have Gabor filtering. So these are the main stages. Okay, so normalization process is normal. First we go for the normalization process, then this orientation estimation and reach frequency estimation. These two steps are necessary for getting the Gabor filter. Okay, so Gabor filtering is basically used for smoothing the fingerprint image. So here Gabor filter is acted as the low pass filter. Okay, and to have the Gabor filtering, we need to go through orientation estimation and reach frequency estimation. So these are the main stages. Okay, so we can have the additional stages also, like segmentation, binarization, thinning. So these are the additional stages. Okay, so you can find all these fingerprint enhancement steps in the paper that has been mentioned at the below of this slide. Here you can see the paper. The title of the paper is the fingerprint image enhancement algorithm and performance algorithm. Okay, so you can study this paper for all these main stages and initial stages which are necessary for enhancement of a fingerprint image. So here you can see the diagram for fingerprint enhancement. So we take an input image, input fingerprint image for the normalization process. So after normalization, we use the normalized image for orientation image estimation. Okay, so after orientation estimation, we go for frequency image estimation, and then we go for region mask generation. So region mask generation is always not necessary. We can omit this step. Okay, and then we can use this orientation estimation and frequency estimation for Gabor filtering. So after Gabor filtering, we can have the enhanced image. So here you can see the enhanced image in the output. Okay. So in the input image, we provide the noisy image. So noisy image may contain the different types of noises. Okay. So when this noisy image goes through a number of pre-processing steps, then at the end of the pre-processing steps, we get an enhanced image. Okay. In the enhanced image, you can see that bifurcation regenting. That means ridges and valleys are found to be very clear. Now the first step, so segmentation is the part of addition stages. However, we use this segmentation step as the first step in fingerprint enhancement process. Okay. So what is segmentation? So basically, by segmentation, we separate the foreground regions in the image from background regions. So if we capture a fingerprint image, then we see there is a foreground region and the background region. That means that foreground region corresponds to the clear fingerprint area that containing the ridges and valleys. Okay. So which will be the area of interest or the region of interest, ROI. Okay. Foreground area or foreground region, and background region correspond to the regions outside the border of the fingerprint area. So this background area does not contain any valid fingerprint information. Okay, that means we cannot find the ridges and valleys in the background area. So background regions generally exhibit a very low grayscale variance value, okay, and foreground regions have very high variance. Now based on this variance parameter, we can compute the variance of foreground region and background region. That means initially we divide the images into a number of blocks, and for each block we calculate the variance. Okay. Now here you can see, if we consider such block K, okay, so here K is one such block, then V of K will represent the variance. Okay. Now V of K equals to 1 by W square. What is W here? So W by W is the size of the block or the dimension of the block. That means around every pixel we get this dimension W by W. That means this W by W we define around every pixel. Okay, that means we define a block, and for that block we obtain the variance in terms of the center pixel. Okay, and then we calculate the variance, and this variance is compared with the global threshold. That means the variance thresholding, we use the variance thresholding. In the variance thresholding, we consider or we take a global variance, and whatever the variance we obtain from every block in the fingerprint image, that variance will be compared with the global threshold. Now if the variance is found to be less than that of the global threshold, then we will say that block correspond to the background region, okay, or part of the background region, and if the variance is found to be greater than the global threshold or global variance, then we will consider that variance is a part of foreground region. That means that clear fingerprint that correspond to the clear fingerprint area or the region of interest. And here I of I of capital I of I comma j is the intensity value of pixel point I comma j. Okay, and here m of k is the mean variance. That means the mean of so here if we consider 3 by 3 block, then this mean of k means the mean of intensity values. Okay, mean of variance or mean of intensity values. So here we get the mean of intensity values that is been subtracted from every pixel in the block, and we take the square of this subtraction, then we get the summation over this difference, and 1 by w square is using to normalize the variance value. Okay, so basically we get the normalized value by dividing with w square. So w by w is the dimension of each block. So here you can see the result of the segmentation. So figure A represents the original image. So here we have the noisy image. Then figure B represents the variance image. So after obtaining the variance for every pixel, we represent that image as a variance image, and figure C represents the segmented image. Okay, so we get the segmented image after getting the variance image. So in the input we provide the original image, and in the output we get the segmented image. Then the next step is the normalization. Now what is normalization? So normalization is used to standardize the intensity values in an image, okay, by adjusting the range of gray level values so that it lies within a desired range of values. So what does this mean, normalization? Now suppose we have the dark fingerprint image. Dark fingerprint image means if we get the corresponding histogram of the dark fingerprint image, then we can represent that histogram as a trade off between the gray level values and the frequency of gray level values. That means if we represent the gray level values along the x axis and frequency of gray level values along the y axis, then the trade off between the gray level values and the frequency of gray level values will give us the histogram. So histogram is nothing but the vertical lines over x axis. Okay, that means if we have the dark fingerprint image, that means the concentration of those vertical lines will be found to be close to the zero. Okay, so zero means we know in the gray levels, zero means black, and 255 means white. That means all the vertical lines will be found to be close to the zero, because the other gray level values will be found to be empty within the range. So we have a range 0 to 255, but the vertical lines due to the dark image will be found close to the zero. So that means the histograms are not histograms in terms of vertical lines is not uniformly distributed over the region. That means we have to create a dynamic region. Okay, we have to create the dynamic range between 0 and 255. That is why this normalization technique is used. Okay, so here normalization is used to standardize the intensity values. So if we have the dark image or less dark image or very brighter image, then we can normalize that image to convert that image into a normal image. So in the normal region, we can see everything very clear. Okay, that means the degenerating, bifurcation, and any other characteristics that are essential for the verification or identification, that are also be found in the normalized image. So here we can see the figure A is using the original image. So original image is very very bright image, or here you can see the image is not very clear. Okay, so if you want to make it clear, then we need to go through the normalization process, and this normalization process will give us the normalized image. That means the dynamic range of the gray level values will become uniform in the range of 0 and 255. Okay, so here we can use this equation. Here n of I comma j is the represent the normalized image, and here capital M and capital V is the estimated mean and variance. Okay, so here capital M represent the estimated mean and capital V represent the estimated variance, and here M0 and V0, so here M0 represent the desired mean. Okay, and V0, capital V0 represent the desired variance. That means if we consider this M0, V0 for the input image or the original image, then we can get the desired result. Desired result means the dynamic range of the gray level values will be found between 0 and 255. That means the histograms will be found uniformly distributed between 0 and 255, not only at one position. That means the histograms will not be found close to the, if we consider this image, then we can see if we get the corresponding histogram, then the histograms will be found close to the 255, because we can see that image is not very clear, image is not dark, image is very light image, all the features are not clearly seen. Okay, therefore if we obtain the corresponding histogram, then the histograms will be concentrated and will be found close to the 255. Okay, so if all the histograms are concentrated and found close to 255, then that is not a uniform distribution. We need the uniform distribution between 0 and 255. Therefore we will apply this normalization technique, and after applying normalization technique, we get the normalized image. Okay, the next step is the orientation estimation. Now what is orientation estimation? So basically orientation field of a fingerprint image defines the local orientation of the ridges contained in the fingerprint. That means at every point on a ridge, we will find or we will compute the local orientation. Okay, and for that we can use the least mean squared estimation method. Okay, so this least mean squared estimation method is used to obtain the local orientation of the ridges contained in the fingerprint. Okay, now what are the different steps are there to obtain the orientation estimation? So firstly, a block of size W by W is centered at pixel I comma j in the normalized fingerprint image. That means to obtain the orientation estimation or local orientation of the ridges, we need the normalized fingerprint image. Okay, in the second step, for each pixel in the block, we compute the gradient. Gradient means the gradient magnitude. Okay, that means if we consider the pixel I comma j, for this pixel we compute, and this pixel is the center pixel of the block W by W. If we consider the value of W is 3, that means we are considering 3 by 3 block. Okay, and the center pixel is I comma j. Now for the center pixel, we will compute the gradient delta x I comma j and delta y I comma j. That is the x component and y component of the gradient, and this gradient are nothing but the gradient magnitudes. Okay, so for that we apply the Sobel operator, horizontal Sobel operator and vertical Sobel operator, and the horizontal Sobel operator gives us the x component, and vertical Sobel operator gives us the y component. Okay, Sobel operator is nothing but the serpentine filter. Okay, and this Sobel operator is also known as the second derivative operator. So all the first derivative and second derivative operators are the gradient operator. Okay, so these derivative operators are used to obtain or used to calculate the gradient magnitude in the x and y directions. Okay, so here we are using horizontal Sobel operator and vertical Sobel operator for calculating the x component and y component. Okay, then we obtain the local orientation at pixel I comma j that can be estimated using the following equations. So this is the equation, that is vx I comma j and vy I comma j. So these are the local orientation as pixel I comma j. That means here we get the gradient magnitudes. Now we use this gradient magnitude to obtain the local orientation at pixel I comma j. Okay, for that we get the variance in the x component, variance in y component, variance in y direction, and variance in x direction. Okay, then this variance this variance in x direction and variance in y direction, both are used to obtain the local orientation theta of I comma j. Okay, so here theta of I comma j will represent the local orientation at pixel I comma j. Okay, and that equals to 1 by 2 tan inverse vy I comma j divided by vx I comma j. So this represent the local orientation at pixel I comma j. Now we need to smooth this orientation field. Okay, and orientation image and smooth, we need to smooth this orientation field in a local neighborhood using Gaussian filter, because in the after obtaining the orientation estimation and frequency estimation, we will obtain the Gaussian filter, okay, or Gabor filter. And to use the Gabor filter for enhancement, fingerprint enhancement, we need to use the Gaussian filter. And this Gaussian filter is nothing but a low pass filter. And this Gaussian filter basically attenuates the high frequency signals, okay, and pass the low frequency signals. That is why it is called the smoothing filter or the low pass filter. So we can use we can smooth the orientation field in a local neighborhood using a Gaussian filter. The orientation image is firstly converted into continuous vector field. What is continuous vector field? So here we can use the x component that is the phi x of I comma j. That is we can previously in the previous step we obtain the local orientation theta. Okay, and this theta will be used to get the continuous vector field in the x direction and y direction. Okay, so that is here phi x and phi y are the x and y components of the vector field. Now we obtain the Gaussian smoothing using these two equations. So here we can obtain the Gaussian smoothing. Okay, so here capital G is a Gaussian low pass filter of dimension w phi by w phi. Okay, so this is the square size of Gaussian filter. So we can use this Gaussian low pass filter to get the smoothing filter. In the final smooth orientation field, that is we can obtain the smoothened local orientation, that is capital O of I comma j equals to half of tan inverse. That is in the previous step we get here we get the x component and y component of continuous vector field, and this vector field are used in the final step where we get the smoothened local orientation capital O. Okay, so here you can see the input image A and input output image B, and this output image is output image B is the orientation estimated. So here we obtain the local orientation, and that that are been marked by the black lines, okay, or a small segment of straight lines. Now for tented arc, here we can see the input image and the corresponding local oriented orientation, local oriented image. For different fingerprint pattern, we can have this orientation estimation. The next that we compute is reach frequency. This reach frequency estimation is done done from a fingerprint image, and that fingerprint image uses the number of blocks. Okay, that means the frequency image here represent the local frequency of the ridges in a fingerprint. Now, what is local frequency of the image? In the first step, the frequency estimation stage is to divide the image into blocks. That means initially we divide the image into number of blocks. Okay, in the next step, we project the gray level values of all pixels located inside each block along a direction orthogonal to the local reach orientation. Okay, that means we obtain the local reach orientation, and the that local reach orientation makes makes orthogonal with the projection of gray level values that are obtained from the pixels which are located inside each block. Okay, so this this projected pixels make the direction which is found orthogonal to the local reach orientation. Okay, in the next step, the projection forms an almost sinusoidal shape wave. So sinusoidal shape wave with the local minimum points corresponding to the ridges in the fingerprint. Now here you can see there are two images, image A and image B. So image A is a small small block in the fingerprint image. Okay, since we are dividing the fingerprint image into a number of blocks, so one such block is the figure A. Okay, so here figure A represent one such block, and the corresponding sinusoidal wave is observed in figure B. So here we can see the corresponding sinusoidal shape wave. So sinusoidal shape wave means in physics, I think you have read this. There is a plane, and on that plane we can have a bell shape like curve. Okay, on the above of the plane and the below below of that plane. So bell shape like curve will be there, and this bell shape like curve will have that will have the different distance from that plane. If we consider there is a plane, and on that plane we have the bell shape curve on the above of that plane and the below of that plane. Okay, with different distances, then that curve will constitute the sinusoidal shape wave. Now, after obtaining the after obtaining orientation estimation and reach frequency estimation, we will go for the Gabor filter. That means now we will consider the orientation estimation and reach frequency estimation for constructing the Gabor filtering or Gabor filter. Okay, now these two parameters will be used to construct the event symmetric Gabor filter. What do you mean by event symmetric Gabor filter? Event symmetric means if we consider a function f of t and another another function f of minus t, then these two functions will be equal. Okay, that means the reverse of these functions will also be equal to the the first function or the former function. So if we consider ft is a function, okay, and the another function we have in the reverse, that is f of minus t, then we can write ft equals to f of minus t. This is called the even symmetry. Okay, so we will construct the even symmetry Gabor filter from these two parameters. The one parameter is the orientation estimation, another parameter is the reach frequency estimation. Okay, and a two-dimensional Gabor filter will be constructed that will consist of a sinusoidal plane wave of a particular orientation and frequency, okay, modulated by Gaussian envelope. Now, what is Gaussian envelope? And particular orientation frequency means we can change the orientation or we can change the frequency. If we consider that two-dimensional Gabor filter will have 8 orientation and 5 frequencies, okay, 8 orientation and 5 frequencies, that means there will be 40 components. That means 8 into 5, okay, 8 into 5 means there will be 40 components will be there for that two-dimensional Gabor filter, because here we are considering 8 orientation and 5 frequencies. Okay, now this two-dimensional Gabor filter will be modulated by Gaussian envelope. Now what is called Gaussian envelope? If we consider the reach frequency estimation in figure B, then figure B, here you can see that sinusoidal shape wave has been seen in the figure B. Okay, now you can see for every bell shape like curve we can have a peak. Okay, now these are called the if we consider these are called the control points. If we connect these control points with a line or with a curve, then these points above the plane and the points below the points will be covered by two different curves. Okay, that means envelope means we need to ensure that something or some comp or some or some or some components need to be inside in the envelope. That means if we consider the sinusoidal shape wave, then sinusoidal shape wave should be covered by two different curves or two different outlining extremes. Okay, that means these extremes will be covered by two different smoothing curve. Okay, and these two different smoothing curve, that means above the plane and below the plane, that means above the plane we will have the bell shape like sinusoidal shape wave, and the below the plane we also have a number of sinusoidal shape wave. Okay, now these two extremes will be covered by two different curves, and this covering concept is called the Gaussian envelope. That means that extremes will be covered by the smoothing curves. Okay, and these smoothing curves are nothing but the Gaussian envelope. And Gabor filters are employed because they have frequency selective and orientation selective properties. Okay, as I told you that we can select the frequency as per the requirement, we can select the orientation as per our requirements. Okay, and that will constitute the components or the filters which are found in the two-dimensional Gabor filter. If we change the orientation or if we change the frequency, then both this orientation and frequency will constitute the number of filters that will be found in a two-dimensional Gabor filter. And these properties allow the filter to be tuned to give maximal response to ridges at a specific orientation and frequency in the fingerprint image. That means if we tune the Gabor filter at a specific orientation and frequency in the fingerprint image, then that orientation and frequency will give us the maximal response to the ridges. That means from those ridges we can have maximum number of features, maximum number of minutiae features. If we want to have the good number of minutiae features and good quality of minutiae features, then at a certain orientation and frequency, we will need to have the maximal response from that ridges. That means we can set those ridges at a specific orientation and frequency to get the maximal response. Okay. Then a properly tuned Gabor filter can be used to effectively preserve the ridge structure while reducing noise. So basically here Gabor filtering, so Gabor filter is nothing but the low pass filter. Okay. And this low pass filter is used to obtain the smoothing image. And this smoothing image basically, when we use the smoothing image or the low pass filter image, this low pass filter is used to reduce the noise. Okay. And high pass filter is used to reflect the sharpening features of the image. The event symmetry Gabor filter is the real part of Gabor function, okay, which is given by cosine wave modulated by a Gaussian. And event symmetry Gabor filter is the special domain that is defined by this equation. So here you can see the equation. So here x theta and y theta is given. Okay. So here sigma square x and sigma square y. Here sigma square x and sigma square y is the two different, here we can see standard deviation. This sigma square x and sigma square are the standard deviation in the x direction and y direction. Okay. And we can use this theta, that is the orientation estimation. Here we have the four parameters for the Gabor function. One is the x, y, theta and f. Okay. So g of x comma y theta comma f. So here xy is the x coordinate and y coordinate of the pixel point. Okay. Theta is the orientation estimation. That means there is the orientation that we can set for the Gabor filter, and f is the frequency. Okay. So specific orientation and specific frequency we can use for this Gabor filter. Now, after obtaining the Gabor filter in this equation, now we will convolve the Gabor filter with the given input image. That is, in the input image we have the fingerprint image. Now Gabor filter is applied to the fingerprint image by specially convolving the image with the filter. Okay. Now Gabor filter means a kernel. Okay. In the last class, I have discussed about the kernel or window or mask. So Gabor filter is nothing but the low pass filter is nothing but the kernel, and that kernel will be convolved with the input fingerprint image. Okay. So convolution of a pixel I comma j in the image will require the corresponding orientation value capital O of I comma j and reach frequency value capital F I comma j of that pixel. Okay. That means when we convolve an image with the Gabor filter, we need to consider the every pixel in the image. Okay. And when we consider the every pixel in the image, the corresponding orientation value and the frequency, reach frequency value of that pixel point will also be considered. That means on that pixel point, we have already computed the orientation value and the reach frequency value. Okay. And then we go for the convolution. So here you can see when we apply the Gabor filter to get the enhanced image capital E. So capital E of capital E of I comma j is the enhanced image. This enhanced image is obtained after convolution of Gabor filter with the fingerprint image. Okay, so here U comma P, here you can see that capital O is the orientation, capital F is the frequency, and capital N of I comma U, okay, I minus U comma J minus V. So this capital N is the normalized image, and here U comma V is the here U comma V, I think is the W by W is the size of the filter, and U will vary from minus WX by 2 to WX by 2. Okay, so this will vary from, so this is U and V are two parameters which are considered for X component and Y component. Okay, so here U varies from minus WX by 2 to plus WX by 2, and V varies from minus WY by 2 to WY by 2. Okay, since we need four parameters in the Gaussian function, so that will convolve with the image, and that and capital E of I comma J represent the enhanced image after convolution. So therefore we need the orientation estimation, we need reach frequency estimation, we need the normal. So on the left hand side we have the original image. Figure A represents the original for filtering. Okay, and if we change the parameter value for different kx and ky, then we can have the different enhanced image. Okay, that means after changing the parameters value, we can have the different forms of enhanced image, and a suitable enhanced image can be selected for further processing or extraction of minutiae features from that enhanced image. Any questions? If you have any questions, you can ask me. Otherwise, I will stop this class now, and we will continue this class in the next day. Any questions?
No, sir.
Okay, that's all for today. Let's have this session end for today. Okay,
sir. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.